After their teenage daughter was targeted during a burglary in January 2009, Brenda Constantine and Brian Rogers followed police advice and made sure she was never alone.
She had a very restricted lifestyle after that.
Their daughter coped in her own way.
We have a spare room, and she stayed in there. She slept with the light on. She still does.
Brenda and Brian, eager to warn others about the threat, called a neighborhood meeting. But odd as it sounds, they say the police asked them to cancel it.
Their objective was to keep this man doing it because he's obviously very intelligent and knows exactly what he's doing. And they thought they had to catch him in the act.
Wait a minute. Using the neighborhood as bait?
Exactly.
The police were doing what they could without success. By November 2009, almost a year after the break-in at Brenda and Brian's home, the intruder was still out there. More than a dozen break-ins had been reported, many involving stolen underwear, shockingly high for this snug, safe neighborhood. Brenda and Brian, now on nervous alert, could not stop wondering who
could
who
it
does?
A woman named Ann Marson Cook and her friend Howard Gray began asking that same question. Ann lives in this lovely old farmhouse, 150 miles away from Brenda and Brian. Howard lives on the same busy highway, not far from the small city of Belleville. November 17, 2009. Late that afternoon, Ann hurried home to change into party clothes. It was her birthday. She was heading to Howard's place to celebrate.
So I was really rushing. I was looking forward to go.
Ann lived alone much of the time in this old place, and that suited her fine. She's a music teacher and artist. She wanted time and space to herself.
I like to have space as my art grows with space.
But did you feel insecure ever before? I mean, did you lock your doors and windows?
No.
Ann's friend, Howard Gray, grew up down the road.
15 years ago, we didn't even take the keys of the ignition of the cars. That's what I grew up with.
That's safe. Well, you knew everybody.
Yeah.
Back on that November day, when Ann got up to her bedroom on the second floor, she looked in the mirror, thinking about what to wear. It was then she noticed something strange in the mirror's reflection. A bedside table with a drawer open.
So I looked at it and I thought, I didn't open this.
She looked at the other bedside table.
The drawer was open. All my sex toys and, I mean, some stuff was gone. And that's when I realized somebody had been in the house.
Had to be a prank. Had to be Howard. He had a set of keys to her place because he often did handyman jobs there. She hopped in her car, drove the 200 yards to his house.
And she came right in and said, "Are you playing a practical joke on me?" No. And so then she proceeded to tell me and jumped right in the car and followed right over behind her.
The two of them traipsed upstairs to Ann's bedroom, discussed at length whether to report the missing sex toys to the Belleville police.
My words were, if we phone the police, it would be nothing but gales of laughter.
Yeah.
My first reaction was to phone the police because somebody had it in the house. I mean, but then he said, think about it.
And so really, it was embarrassment.
No,
it's
just
embarrassment. We were just thinking reality of what will happen if you phone.
They were also trying to decide if maybe they should be laughing, too. Maybe it really was a joke. But if so, who could have been behind it?
I was thinking, it's somebody that knows me.
They'll come up in the morning, you know, maybe in the mailbox with a ha-ha-ha or something like that.
There's a reason they recall that conversation in minute detail, a terrifying reason. But on this evening, they did not know that yet, as they prepared to return to Howard's house for the birthday party he was throwing her. And it was simply an excess of caution when he told her, bring her pajamas.
I said to her, obviously someone's been in the house. You're not staying alone tonight.
And this was important. Before they left, they locked Ann's house up tight, just in case.
All we did was just went around all the windows and doors and made sure everything, and she went in front of me and I went behind her and I double-checked everyone.
That night they partied with friends, drank Howard's homemade strawberry wine, made light of the bizarre theft. Perhaps the new day would reveal the prankster. Then, 7:45 next morning, they were back at the farmhouse. Ann ran upstairs to her home office to do some photocopying. Howard waited below. Then he heard Anne's terrified scream.
I was like, how hard? You know, my work boots were still on, but in about three steps, I was up where she was, and she was standing with her hands like this.
Standing and staring at the old desk computer she hadn't fired up for months, and the screen was glowing in the dim morning light, a message that shook Anne Marson Cook to the core.
I took it so personally. I knew someone was out there for me, and that was very, very scary.